Now, Adam, so, you know, so with all of this being said, this whole notion, what part does the church have in this? Or is some of it coming from a degree of, we always hear the term church hurt or whatever. And no pun intended here, but I mean, is part of this kind of a black eye of the church, maybe?
Well, I mean, I think you know all too well like how this stuff is unfortunately played out, man. I mean, you do have and I'll just say on a personal level, I have come across a number of people who I would say, I guess you could say they've turned to atheism as a result of like direct church hurt. You know, maybe they were going to a church and the church mother says something to them some kind of way, and now that they're out the door, and next thing you know, they're an atheist. I mean, you do have people like that to where they've had themselves experiences at their local church that they didn't turn out well, and they find themselves being atheists. But then on the broader scale, I mean, we do have this historical issue that has to be addressed. It is a fact of the matter that there were scores of people who profess to be Christians who enslaved African Americans. It is a fact of the matter that you have, I think it's Pope Innocent, writing papal bulls that justified enslaving people in pagan lands. It is a fact of the matter. And when it comes to you have with 100 over 100 some treaties broken with Native Americans, under the 500, is that right?
500 plus, yeah.
Right. So if you have 500 plus treaties, broken with Native Americans, and you have this group saying that the basis behind what they're doing is this notion of manifest destiny and God's sovereignty and all these kinds of things, and they're coupling, the priest with the political bandit, who's doing these things, you have this cooperation between the priest and the pirate, if you will. And that's problematic, because people say, well, man, if that's what your God is about, I'm out. I don't want any parts of that. And so you have both in the past and now, you do have this notion of, well, hey, Christianity, as Dr. John Henry Clark said back in the day, has been the handmaiden of white supremacy. Now, in fact, that's historically surface level, and it doesn't do justice to what the full historical record has to say. But nevertheless, the church, okay, the individuals past and present do bear some responsibility in terms of how we reflect Christ in the world. And when we drop the ball, then there could be negative consequences, even to the extent of driving people away from the God that we claim to serve. And such is the case, when it comes to the history of the church here in the Western world. And I think that it really speaks to I'll just say, I think we have a moral obligation today to be honest about that and to help people to navigate through those kinds of things. Because the fact of the matter is this, here's the thing. Before the African American, the transatlantic slave trade, I'll put it that way. Before the first white man set foot and stepped to a Native American and what have you, and broke that first treaty, okay, approximately 1,500 years before that, Jesus Christ of Nazareth walked the earth. You know what I'm saying? He healed, he cast out demons. He preached the gospel. He let people know that he is King Jesus, and that was exemplified and brought about by his dying on the cross for the sins of mankind, 3 days after which he rose from the grave. And we have good reason to affirm that based upon the historical evidence that can't be accounted for by any naturalistic explanation. This is something that's well documented, right? So the Jesus rose from the grave long before there was ever a white man on Western soil doing dirt to whatever extent that they did. And so what happens is, I just saw somebody asking the chat, like, how can you justify believing in the religion that was imposed upon your ancestors during slavery? Well, the answer is that if we want to think through these things logically, okay, it's important to, think through things logically. And the reality is, I don't want to fall into what's called the genetic fallacy, which is where you affirm or deny a position based upon how somebody came to believe it. The question of how somebody came to believe it is independent from whether or not something is true. And so, if I've got evidence that God exists, if I have evidence that Jesus said what he said, taught what he taught, and did what he did, and if I've got evidence that Jesus Christ rose from the grave, then I am logically within my logical rights, within my rational rights to affirm that Christianity is true, independent of what some white men did 1,500 or so years after the fact, right? And so these are the kinds of things, that we have to help people work their way through. If other people want to be illogical and just kind of, base their worldview on emotions, I mean, they're certainly free to do so. But I'm seeking truth. I'm saying I'm really about evidence. I'm really about truth. I'm really about thinking logically. Right. And when I follow the evidence where it leads, when I sit back and look at the human experience and try to account for it, the best account is Christian theism. So that's where we go.